Today. My name is Bo Bernard. I'll be filling the pulpit today. I'm here with my beautiful wife, Julie, and my daughter, Alyssa. Want to say thank you for the opportunity to come back here. I was here about a month ago, I believe, right around. Praise God, it's a beautiful day. You have to give me just a second. Let me get my notes out and get everything ready here. Okay. I want to start today's message. This is going to be a little bit of a tough one. It's going to step on some toes, I hope, in a good way. But I want to start this with a few little questions. I like questions, as you'll find out the more you listen to me. First question: what does it mean to live a gospel-centered life? Another question: how can one explain their faith to others? And how do we share our relationship with God? Moreover, what's a little more important, this question we need to be asking ourselves: what is my relationship with God? What is my role in that relationship with God? Well, then we need to think about relationships are built on one major component: trust. If you don't have trust, you don't have a relationship at all. Both sides must put real effort into doing their part for a relationship. And that's one thing that we need to remind ourselves every day. God always fulfills his part. But what about us? Are we really willing to dig in and do our part? Do we spend time in prayer? Do we spend time in scripture? Do we fulfill our part in fellowship with each other, encouraging others to be closer to God? This is crucial. We've got to put our effort into the learning, into the studying, and into listening. You ever notice that God listens to us all the time, but many times we fail in listening to him? Now, when you think about this, how do you explain? If you don't have a real solid grounding of who God is, of what he has done for you, how can you ever expect to explain that to someone who is lost, or even maybe someone who's young in their faith but struggling? This is important because we need to understand who God is. We need to understand him and his character. We need to understand how he acts in his action. This lack of knowledge that so many do have leads to what I believe is a very frail and weak argument. And that argument is based on free will. We will discuss that later on. I do believe in free will. But free will is not a good answer for who God is, or why he does what he does, or why he allows certain things to happen. Now, to do this, to understand who God is to us, we're going to go back to the very beginning. We're going to be in the book of Genesis. We're going to start in the first chapter of Genesis. And we're going to be looking at verses 26 and 27 of the first chapter. And then we're going to move from there into chapter 2. And we're going to look at basically verses 9 through the rest of this chapter and the first 7 verses of chapter 3. Don't worry, we're not going to go verse by verse. I'm not going to break every single point down, I promise. But starting in verse 26 of Genesis, it says this: "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock, the whole earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth.' So God created man in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them male and female." All right, now let's move ahead just a little bit. And we're going to be starting, like I said, picking up in verse 9 of chapter 2. Let me rephrase that. Verse 7 is where we're going to start. It says, "Then the Lord God formed the man out of the dust from the ground and breathed the breath of life into his nostrils, and the man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he placed the man he had formed. The Lord God caused to grow out of the ground every tree pleasing in appearance and good for food, including the tree of life in the middle of the garden, as well as the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
A river went out from Eden to water the garden. From there, it divided and became the source of four rivers. The name of the first is Pishon, which follows through the entire land of Havilah, where there is gold. Gold from that land is pure. Bdellium and onyx are also there. The name of the second river is Gihon, which flows through the entire land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris, which runs east of Assyria, and the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to work it and watch over it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree of the garden, but you must not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For on that day you eat from it, you will certainly die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper corresponding to him." The Lord God formed out of the ground every wild animal and every bird of the sky and brought each to the man to see what he would call it. And whatever the man called a living creature, that was his name. The man gave names to all of the livestock, to the birds of the sky, and to every wild animal. But for the man, no helper was found corresponding to him. So the Lord caused a deep sleep to come over the man, and he slept. God took one of his ribs and closed the flesh at that place. Then the Lord God made the rib he had taken from the man into a woman and brought her to the man. And the man said, "This one, at last, is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. This one will be called woman, for she was taken from man. This is why a man leaves his father and mother, and bonds with his wife, and they will become one flesh. Both the man and his wife were naked, yet they felt no shame." Now, starting in chapter 3. Now the serpent was the most cunning of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you can't eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit from the trees in the garden, but about the tree of the fruit in the middle of the garden, God said, you must not eat it or touch it, or you will die." "No, you will not die," the serpent said to the woman. "In fact, God knows that when you eat it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." The woman saw that the tree was good for food and delightful to look at, and that it was desirable for obtaining wisdom. So she took some of its fruit and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. So the Lord God called out to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" Okay, now like I said, we're not going to go through all of these verses. But there was a lot of good information, and I'll give you some backstory there. The first point that I want us to fix ourselves on is that God's intention for man is that he live forever in the blessings of his will. Now I want you to keep in mind when I say that, the his, he wants man, that's small lowercase, that's what we are. But when he wants us to live forever in his blessings, that's capital H, in God's blessings. And you ask, okay, well, how do you get that evidence from the scripture we read? If you look at the second chapter, when he talks about the garden, the first thing we'll look at, or wait a minute, I'm sorry. The first thing we need to point out is God created man in his own image and his own likeness. That was taken from chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. God is absolutely perfect and holy. And for him to make us in his image and moreover in his likeness, in other words, God gave us a character similar to his. Why would you do that about a creation you didn't care about? Well, the simple fact is you wouldn't. Moving ahead, now it says from chapter 2, verse 7, God breathed life into man. He loved his creation so much,
He breathed the life into Adam when he created. So to speak, when each and every one of you were born, God is the one. He's the author of life. He breathed that opening life into you. So your first breath is God breathed, and your last breath will be as well. Now, let's move to the point I was making when I got ahead of myself a little earlier. God planted the garden in Eden, containing the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Both of those are important. The tree of life speaks to the main point that God has in mind for us to live forever. And here's how you know that. The tree of life, Adam and Eve would have never descended or never passed on had they not committed the original sin, the fall in the garden. That's what the tree of life is for. That tree of life was an eternal wellspring of life. And you see it now, fast forward years later. The fall happened, man is cursed, separated, they were thrown out of the garden, they were separated from the tree of life. But look where we're at now. We have a holy Lord and Savior who stepped down from his throne in heaven. Jesus came to pay the propitiation for your sins. And in doing so, if you're willing to accept him as Lord and Savior, if you're willing to make him number one in your life, you once again are granted eternal life in paradise with the Father. See, that's important because it's not just Jesus that we need to think, because Jesus and God are one. We know that we, as Christians, are to be Trinitarian, which means God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. Three very distinct and separate essences in one holy and divine nature. That's important. If you would, you don't have to turn there. Everybody here knows it knows it very easily. But what does John 3:16 say? Let me read it from my Bible so I don't slip anything up. It says this. It says, "For God loved the world in this way. He gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life." So, the key to knowing God is knowing that God values you and has plans, eternal plans, for your life. This is a mere stepping stone, a tiny grain of sand compared to eternity. And he wants you there. So, the other thing, the knowledge of good and evil. That tree was very important. It may not have had such importance had they not chose to eat it. But since they did, now we have a knowledge, somewhat, of good and of evil. It's a finite knowledge. And that tree was of infinite wisdom, which is why it was so dangerous for them to eat it. But the whole thing, we do have a knowledge of good and evil, and we have a holy God who is here to guide us and direct us. He gave us this book, that if we would follow this book, that if we would live for him and follow his commandments as best as we can avoid the pitfalls of evil, follow the steps of good, lead closer to his will. Second thought, God cares about man. He cares about his creation greatly, which means he cares about each and every one of you out here. He cares in ways that we can't even comprehend. So how does he care? Well, number one, first point, God provided every possible necessity that man had in the garden. He provided food, he provided protection, and he provided man a helper. So how did he provide the food? He caused the trees of the garden to grow, to produce an abundance of fruit. Imagine walking in a garden that was the most beautiful garden you ever saw. And imagine your favorite fruits readily available. And at this time, we have to remember, this was a perfect garden. We didn't have the unpredictable, or they didn't have, let me say, the unpredictable conditions that we have now. Droughts, floods, things of that nature. He created the rivers around this garden so that it would always be watered, it would always bring, and it would always produce.
He created the animals so that they would have meat to feast off of. He gave them every reliable source they could hope for. Another thing, the garden was set amidst four rivers, providing protection from the elements around it. If you look at it, if you've ever seen a map of where the Garden of Eden is guessed to have been located, it's funny that this beautiful garden, this perfect garden, sat in the middle of an arid, dry desert. Harsh elements that typically would make it very difficult to survive in. But as difficult as they tried to make it to survive in, God provided protection, provided four rivers out of one major river. They always had protection from the outside world. In our time today, God gives us protection. Each other, we are called to be protection for each other. When you see your brother or your sister stumble, when you see them headed down a path that you know is wrong and that you know they shouldn't be headed down, you're called to rebuke them. You're called to encourage them and get them on the right track. You're called to love that lost world. You're called to protect your brothers and sisters. There's protection in the walls of this church. You ever walk in here on a Sunday morning? And let's see, I know there's three crosses back there. You look around and you see those things and you just kind of feel like you're in the presence of God. And you have that moment and you pray. Maybe one of your family members here comes up and puts a hand on your shoulder and prays with you. That is God's protection. So he's provided all the necessities. He's built the garden and given them protection. And his provision. God knew that man couldn't survive alone. So he made him a helper. None of the animals would do. They wouldn't suffice in the proper way. So he put Adam to sleep. And he made the woman. Now, I don't know about y'all, but that's an important one for me because as a man, my house does not run right without the woman. She's the backbone of that family, and she's what holds it together. She's the super glue. God knew that, you know, with the creation of man, let's be real, we're foolish. I know I am. I'm very foolish. I talk too much. And it's nice to have a wife to kind of elbow and give that nudge saying, hey, it's time to hush. It's good to have a wife that'll remind me when something needs to get done around the house because, truth be told, I tend to be a little unmotivated in those things until I get certain motivations. Now, let's move forward a little bit and let's look now at this. He provided warnings of the dangers of eating the forbidden fruit, of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This was to protect man from sinning and from falling under the curse of sin leading to destruction. Now, it's kind of funny. We know that Eve was tempted. The serpent was very cunning, very crafty, and he got her when she was alone. And we'll talk about that a little more. But make no mistake, God knew that they could not handle it. He knew that man alone, that we do not have the proper power to exercise authority over something such as good and evil. So he gave them an adamant warning. He told him, do not eat of this fruit, lest you will surely die. I take great comfort in that warning. Because I know that if God was willing to warn them that when I'm coming to the pitfalls, if I have the relationship that I should have with God, if I communicate with him daily, if I talk to him through my prayers, if I listen to him through the reading of Scripture, through wise counsel from other godly members, he will provide that warning to keep me from stumbling into those pitfalls. The biggest part is that I listen, that I heed those warnings. And you see that from Genesis 2, 16 and 17. We're not going to go back over it. But that's very important. Now, another thing. We've talked about how he finds value in man. But because the value that God finds in his creation, He will allow man to choose his path, even when man's choice opposes his will. Without this choice, we could not have a real and true relationship. That simple phrase right there explains why God commanded Adam not to eat of that fruit. He laid out the consequences of disobeying that command. He gave Adam every chance that he could. He gave him every warning. But the simple fact is our God values his creation, and he loves us so much that he still gives us a chance. Let me ask you a question. Would you ever want to be in a relationship where somebody was active in that relationship only because they had to be? What value would there be in a relationship where we were mindless drones or robots and God had made us where he didn't even have to talk to us and we just went humdrum about our day, did everything, ding, 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 perfect? It would be worthless. There would be no value in it. But God values man. He finds great value in man. So therefore, he allows us to choose. Now, that is a form of free will, and we will be getting into that. But make no mistake, just because he allows you to choose does not mean that you should go off and just choose by your own will, because we are frail, we are broken, and we are incompetent. The second point on this is this. The serpent twisted the truths God had revealed to Adam and Eve. Man, though made in the image of God, does not have the power to practice the authority over good and evil. I talked about that a while ago. We do not have the holiness of our Creator. Not even close. When God created man, he created man for fellowship with him, but also he created man to be subject to him. And since we are subject to a perfect, holy God, and we cannot be perfect, we cannot handle the responsibility of practicing the authority over something as important as good or evil. And if you don't believe me, just take a look at the world around you today and see where we're at. That's why it's so important that we're in here, that we are praising and worshiping and fellowshipping with God and with each other. See, the other thing, God knew that man couldn't handle this. That's why God laid out the rule. But so did that little serpent. Satan knows, and he knows how to take that truth and twist it just a little bit. What Satan told Eve was not an out-and-out, every ounce of it lie. It was a very bold, direct lie, but it had a lot of increments of truth. But he just took that little bit of a turn, just that slight little twist. Make no mistake, when you twist the truth, even the slightest little bit, it is still a lie. It is no longer the truth. He knew that he was going to have to prey upon Eve when she was alone, which he did. And he knew that he was going to have to produce a fallacy, a lie, so to speak, that seemed like truth, but was very, very far from it. That fallacy was one of the first acts we ever seen. Well, actually, it is the first reported act in the Bible of free will. That's a dangerous act. So when someone comes to you and they want to ask you about why God allows this to happen or this to happen, be very, very careful bringing up free will. Not to say that it doesn't exist, not to say that it is not important, but it's a frail argument, it's a weak argument, and it often will lead to rebellion and sin, even when you don't intend it to be. He wanted her to feel puffed up. I want you to understand this. This is a history Bible that I'm reading out of. And there was an ancient preacher, y'all probably heard of him, very well known, very famous, Chrysostom. And he says it like this. Let me get to that right page. He says, "Do you see how the devil led her captive, handicapped her reasoning, and caused her to set her thoughts on goals beyond her real capabilities in order that she might be puffed up with empty hopes and lose her hold on the advantages already accorded to her?" See, here's the thing that we have to be careful of. Adam and Eve already had dominion over the serpent. They were given authority over the serpent and, in a sense, authority over evil. But he was able to get her alone. He was able to get her separated. And he was able to puff up her ego. See, a lot of that happened today. And what happened? She started setting her goals on things that she could not do. Do we dare do the same things to ourselves? Do we dare say, I think maybe I can do it? Unfortunately, I think we see too much of it. I have done it personally where I've been like, okay, I've got something to do. I'm going to go ahead and do it. And more times than not, pretty much every time, I find myself in tears, on my knees, crying out to God when I couldn't do it. And the reason I'm having to cry out so bad is because I didn't go to God in the first place. I didn't get down on my knees and prepare myself for that. So that goes on to my next point, which is this. An act of free will led to the separation of man from God and his blessings in the garden. This act represented man's free agency in rebellion to God and direct apostasy, resulting in slavery to the bondage of sin. Now you notice I used a different term here. Instead of free will, I call it free agency. I'm going to give you the definition and I think you'll see why. Free agency is defined as a person who is self-determining and is not responsible for his or her actions to any authority. Therefore, with one act of free agency, mankind now has been plagued. We're cursed by the plague of sin. We're in desperate need of salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Praise God that we have a Lord and Savior. That God loved us so much that he sent his Son from his throne on high to come and pay the propitiation for our sins, to hang on a cross. Make no mistake, my actions, my sins, each and every sin that you have committed, along with every person in the world, we're the ones that drove those nails in his hands. Yet he came. He was mocked on, spat at, beat, scourged in a way that none of us could ever even consider surviving. And he did it all knowing it was going to happen for each and every one of you. I hope you'll remember the last time that we talked, I preached to you about gospel love. We looked at 1 John chapter 4. And I included the first 7 verses where it talked about the litmus test. Very easy to see if somebody is truly about God and about the Bible. Do they preach the gospel? Does their message point you to Jesus Christ? My thought here when I look at that is, it better point to Jesus Christ, and in pointing to Jesus Christ, it better point us to God. Because Jesus Christ and God our Lord is one and the same. And if you look in chapter 3 of Romans, verses 10 through 12, will settle an age-old argument for a lot of people. Starting in verse 10, now this is a quote from Psalms 14, verse 3, but it says here, Paul said this, he said, as it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, there is no one who seeks God. All have turned away, all alike have become worthless. There is no one who does what is good, not even one. Ouch. That's pretty scary. But that's applicable to the free will argument. Acts of free will, oftentimes more than not, are what lead to sin. So, in conclusion, I'd like to say this. It says, God loves man beyond his comprehension. He loves us beyond anything that we can understand. We know that. Every good thing we have is directly because of his provision. You got a home that's got a warm bed at night, cool in the day, you have food on the table. That's all because of God. A lot of people like to tell you, well, no, that's not because of God.
I've got a job and I work every day. You wouldn't have that job if it wasn't for the grace of God to give it to you. God values us in our relationship with Him and seeks that we openly choose Him and His will. Think about this. All of the creatures of the earth, the title given to women was not done by God, it was done by man. God trusted Adam. He valued Adam enough to value what Adam thought was an appropriate name. God still trusts in you. He values your thoughts. He values your opinions. He already knows when you're hurting. He already knows when you're upset, even when you're upset at Him. He wants you to be open enough to tell Him anyway. He is the best listener you will ever find. That's why we are told so fervently to pray. Not only does He do that, but just because there may be an alternative approach to His life, we should not choose such a route based on our limited understanding. Should never think that you know enough to make important godly decisions on your own. And make no mistake, it doesn't have to be big decisions. Little things still need God's input, because you will get off straight, off course, in the ditch astray really, really fast. Satan knows how to twist that truth, guys. And I guarantee you, he's going to do that mild twisting in here, in the church, in your home, in your private house. That's where he's really going to do it. He's not going to do it out on the public streets. He's not going to do it in the beer joints. He doesn't need to be there. Most of those people already are fallen and astray. He's going to do it where it counts. He may not be able to steal your salvation, but he can destroy your witness. And destroying your witness is very dangerous, because as Matthew 28:19-20 says, "Go therefore and make disciples in my name, teaching them to disciple." What good is it going to be if you've ruined your witness and you've lost your credibility? So don't listen to your own self, or don't listen to somebody if it doesn't line up with Scripture, if it doesn't line up with the gospel. And lastly, think about this. That age-old question, we talked about it earlier, it says, when someone asks you this, when they say, why would a perfect God, a holy God, a righteous God, when he asks the reason, if this God is so good, why would he allow the bad things that happen in this world to happen? Especially, why would he allow bad things to happen to good people? First thing to remember is, remember Romans 3. Mankind has been corrupted by sin and the fall of the garden. And therefore, by God's standards, no one is good. None is good. My very best that I can give up here or any given Sunday is nothing but a dirty, filthy rag compared to the glory of the Holy God. It's not about what I can do. It's about what Christ does in me and through me. The very same for each and every one of you. That's what makes us acceptable. The blood of Christ from the cruel cross of Calvary. So when they ask you for that reason, remember, first off, tell them, say, hey, truth be told, none of us are good enough. By the grace of God, we don't get what we truly deserve. And then just remind them, it's about the free agency man declares for himself that leads to so much destruction. No man is good enough, guys, apart from the grace of Jesus Christ. Apart from salvation, we are powerless to accomplish anything of any value, of any worth in this life. You might could be the biggest billionaire businessman, you might could make millions, and you might can do great things for charity. But if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's all going to be counted as lost, it's all going to be counted in vain, and none of it is going to make a difference on that judgment. But if you live for Jesus, if you love the Lord with all your heart and you seek Him, praise God, you will hear a different note on that day. You will hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Come into the presence of me in paradise."
So with that, my final thought for y'all today. May we be obedient to God, be subject to Him in love and praise for all of His blessings, for all of His glory, and for all of His honor. With that, I'd like to conclude. Thank you.